Hello and welcome to the Best of Heritage 2022. I'm Tom Loughman, joining you from the United States. Today I have the pleasure of speaking with Leen Beyers, head of the curatorial team at the Museum aan de Stroom, the MAS Antwerpen. Her institution's showcase of the Congolese collections was contextualized by revisiting the city's relationship with its colonial past in the exhibition 100 Times Congo, which was recently recognized as the Museum and Heritage International Museum Exhibition of the Year. Welcome, Leen.
Thank you, and it's really a pleasure for me and my team to be able to present this exhibition.
Well, I'm wondering if we can begin with you briefly describing how 100 Times Congo fits within the overall program of MAS.
Yes, the MAS is a museum in Antwerp, Belgium. It's a young museum, 11 years old, and but it has old collections. And we always show exhibitions on Antwerp and its relations to the world. And this exhibition, entitled 100 Times Congo, A Century of Congolese Art in Antwerp, was opened in September 2020. And this 2020 was the 60th anniversary of the independence of the former Belgian colony, Congo. At the same time, it was the centennial of the presence of the Congolese collection in the city of Antwerp. Antwerp is a port city, and at the start of the 20th century, it was a port involved a lot in colonial trades. Ivory and rubber came to Antwerp. People in Antwerp earned a lot with these trades. And it is in this context that these Congolese objects arrived in the city, and they are now part of the MAS collection. So that's was the context and for us the stimulus to make this exhibition.
Wonderful. It seems like it's a balance of both a celebration of Congolese independence, the 60th anniversary, but also a reckoning of a problematic colonial past seen through the eyes of a city that experienced Congolese material culture and very important cultural artifacts in different ways over time. I'm wondering if you could tell us a little bit about the history of how the exhibition developed and how you were able to combine both those important stories of celebration and of the problematic past in Belgium.
Mm-mm. Yeah, we very much felt that we had to do something with this collection, that we had to make it more visible and to tell new stories about the collection. But we felt that we should widen the perspective of the museum, and that's why we appointed two curators. On the one hand, the keeper of the African collection, Els de Palmenaar, and on the other hand, Nadia Nessai, a political scientist of Congolese origin. And with their two perspectives, different backgrounds, also different study backgrounds, we very much could tell new stories about the exhibition, and also collaborate with new people we didn't know before, very interesting artists, guides. So that's how we developed this exhibition.
Wonderful. And then COVID happened. How did that change the delivery of the experience of the exhibition?
Well, we expected before COVID to have at least 100,000 visitors in the exhibition. The reactions before the opening were very positive. There was a lot of curiosity, but then COVID happened, so we had to postpone the opening date. And in the end, we have received half of the visitors because more was not possible. And we had attracted very interesting young people from African backgrounds who worked as guides for the exhibition and who have helped us a lot to turn the exhibition into a virtual exhibition in the end. And that's also, this virtual exhibition was used for schools because schools couldn't come as a group to the exhibition. It has also been used for a presentation and a debate in Kinshasa, which was also important to do. We feel that this is very important to show this story and to connect really closely with experts and people in Congo. And so that's, in a way, COVID helped us also to do that.
Yeah, I mean, you were thrust into the digital. And that may have broadened the conversation. Do you think that was maybe one of the particular qualities or innovative parts about the show that impressed the jury?
We felt very much that the jury has appreciated how we have instilled the debate in our exhibition. They called the exhibition, and we are really thankful to the jury for this. They called it brave, and that makes us really proud because, in a way, we managed to be at the heart of the debates, of the social debate with the exhibition. We have, amongst others, through collaborating with an artist in residence, Patrick Mudekereza from Congo, who wrote very explicit quotes on the showcases. Also, thanks to a film project in many hands, we had 25 people from both Antwerp and Kinshasa who commented on our collection. We have very, very much tried to invite the debate into our exhibition. And I think this was very much appreciated by the jury, we felt.
Yeah, and as it should be. That's wonderful. Could you tell me any stories about particular difficulties or positive experiences that you had as an institution in the course of the realization of the project?
As mentioned before, COVID was really a challenge, and we all hoped it would not have happened, of course. But looking how to position ourselves as museum in this social debate was a challenge. And our communication campaign, we are happy that they found a solution also for this, because I have a poster here, and it's with a question mark, as you can see. It's not the title of an exhibition, but it asks, how did we look at Congo? How do you look at Congo? How will we look at Congo? So it very much took the reflection and the invitation to reflection as the topic of the communication campaign. I feel very much that as curators, we want to be polyphonous in our exhibition, but often it is difficult for our colleagues of communication to translate this, because yes, they want to have an easy message, a simple title, open and easy for everyone. And we were very happy that we came to this open questions for the communication campaign, and we had very positive reactions on that.
Wonderful. Well, when you consider the timeliness of this topic, amid a reckoning of decolonization that's happening around the world now in our institutions, how readily did the general public seem to take this story, the general public in Antwerp, the general public in Kinshasa? And was this exhibition a personally emotional or attitude-transforming experience for many? Do you know if people were moved to a different point of view by what they experienced?
Yes, much more than some other exhibitions we made. This exhibition has been, has had a lot of impact, we feel. Comments in newspapers, but also on social media. They show this. For instance, IO is an African youth organization, students mainly, and they organized a commemoration for the seven people who died at the World Exhibition in Antwerp in 1894. In our exhibition, we named those people. It was for the first time in many years that these victims that they received a name, that we could detail who they were, the age they had. So these seven people were part of a large group of 144 people who were presented as a human zoo in Antwerp, 1894. And so spontaneous from the fact that this information was in our exhibition and the photos and the story, they organized a commemoration. There were also other people who became or were maybe already very critical about the presence of this collection in Antwerp, who didn't know about this before. Others were surprised because the collection had been rather invisible the years before. There were a lot of feelings surrounding the exhibition. One very special, several special things happened, but on a day the museum guards found broken cola nuts near one of the artworks, one of the Congolese objects. And cola nuts have a special meaning in West Africa and Congo. They might be used to make a tribute or a wish to the Congolese sculptures. And we decided not to disturb this and to leave the nuts for a while there. Mm-hmm. So this was, without words, a very strong performance, let's say. We also had a visit of Mwazulu Diabanza. It's an activist with regard to looted art. And he has visited recently several museums in Europe, and we decided to invite him to our exhibition and to give him a guided tour. And it was, of course, not easy because we didn't know how he would react, but he very much appreciated that we were very open about the painful past, about the problematic past, about the looting of objects, and that we named things as they named people, and he called it a step towards restoring the past. And this is, of course, something the museum or the curators do not say about themselves. We hope, of course, that we can, in a way, contribute to sort of a restoration or sort of decolonization. But either people like Diabanza and other people, activists and others who really have to give their opinion. That's so that was we were very that was very interesting.
I think it's wonderful that you were able to catalyze a return of dignity culturally, and it wasn't just inside the museum. It sounds like it was very much a broader a broader effort. I have to believe that comes from the fact that you brought in many voices, guest voices, and gave the story back to the community. Do you think that the project will have a professional legacy of more inclusive storytelling, either in Belgium or more broadly?
For the MAS, it was really an important project. We had experience with giving voice to alternative perspectives, with including contemporary testimonies in exhibitions. But this was really a radical way of showing polyphony, of enhancing polyphony in an exhibition. And we very much feel that when we create exhibitions on sensitive topics, we really have to we really have to create a platform for polyphony. And of course, the way in which you do this depends very much on the topic and the network you create surrounding this Congolese collection. They, for another part of our collection, they will be different. For instance, now we are working on a project in relation to gender. That's a different game, let's say. But we very much have learned how to not to just present a history and maybe include some projects, minor projects with other perspectives, but really, if there is a complex debate in society, to in a way put it at the heart of your exhibition.
I think that's the bravery that the jury recognized in your project. I have one last question. If you could share the exhibition with other communities, like, you know, tour the show or in some ways give it over to another museological context, you know, which stories would you prioritize and why? How would you need to change or sculpt the checklist to give people an experience that would be meaningful for them?
It's not easy because of the specific Belgian Congolese history to copy paste this exhibition in itself to another museum in Europe. But we feel very much that it is important to share and to show this story in Congo. And for the catalog, we have worked with Congolese authors. We have already done a virtual presentation. We are very much collaborating now for a provenance research project with people in Congo. And we think the big step forward for this collection, but also for other overseas extra-European collections we have in the museum is to collaborate with people in the countries of origin and to show them there.
Wonderful. Leen, I want to thank you. Congratulations. It's been a delight talking with you today.
It was also a delight for me, and we thank you very much for the opportunity to tell about this project. The book.